We're at Worldcon 74 talking with Kaja Foglio, the other half of the creative team for Girl Genius, which is a steampunk comic book novel story universe. We were talking to your husband about the genesis of all of this. What's your version of the story of how all of this started?
What's my version of the story? Well, let's see. There was a point where Phil was coming to an end with some of the work he'd already been doing, finishing up some old series. And he was trying to think of, what should I do next? What should I work on? And one of our friends looked at him and said, why don't you just do something new? You know, not one of your old properties. Why don't you do something new? And Phil stood there looking kind of poleaxed and said, what a strange idea. And so we were kind of thinking in that direction already, or he was. And meanwhile, I'd been banging away at something with mad science and trying to think about something to do with mad scientists, because I like that. And what came out of a lot of conversations and a lot of walking was the idea of something kind of sideways connected to some of Phil's old work, but you know, the name Heterodyne is actually a name he'd used in some earlier stories, and that's now the name of the main character. Her name is Agatha Heterodyne, and let's see. Trying to think of what else to say.
Well, the concept of Girl Genius is, as I understand it, you have your protagonist, your heroine.
Yeah.
who apparently is a long-lost descendant and heir of the evil mad scientist family that was supposedly wiped out all these years ago.
Yes.
And now it's been discovered that she's actually a mad scientist's relative. So what was your starting point for coming up with the story? I mean, you've got all of these elements that you want to incorporate, the mad science and the female protagonist. What was the kernel of the story that started?
The kernel of the story, I think, is the title Girl Genius, which is something that Phil came up with. He came home from a convention that I did not go to. He came home with two drawings. One was just a headshot of the character. He says, look, I drew you. Yeah, well, I was 22 at the time. Very nice of him. And then a full shot of her and the words Girl Genius. And he said, yeah, you know, she's like a mad scientist. And she's like the descendant of these like Doc Savage kind of characters. And it'll be cool. And we were still looking at doing it as a near future type science fiction thing at that time. And it was only later that we said, you know, maybe we should make it match the couch. You know, we like all this old stuff. We like, you know, at that time we had a lot of Magic the Gathering money flying around with us and our friends. And so one of the things we would all do on weekends is go up to the little town up north of Seattle where they actually have a lot of antique malls. And so we were all like looking at all these Victorian antiques all the time. I was sorting through Phil's old files at that time, and I was organizing everything because he just had sheafs of paper, old drawings, old fan art. And I said, so matching the couch is kind of a joke, because I also was looking at all these old these pieces of artwork, and I was saying, well, you know, you've got science fiction stuff, you've got fantasy stuff, but mixed in here are all these cats with top hats, and, you know, here's Locomotive Lars, this superhero with like a train grill on his face, and, you know, all of this stuff that now we would look at and say, oh, that's steampunk. And I said, you know, you've never done anything that looks like this. That's really cool. You know, and Phil said, well, I've never really had a use for it. I mean, I've never had a place to put it. And I said, well, you know, we're talking mad scientists here. You know, one of my favorite books is Frankenstein, Mary Shelley. That's old stuff. Maybe we should go with the old stuff. Maybe we should look like that. Maybe, you know, I mean, we like Lovecraft. Maybe we should go in that direction. And so that's how we ended up going a little more oldie-timey.
Take me through the process then, because Phil says that he does most of the art.
Yes.
You do the story with him. What's the division of labor here?
We spend a lot of time wandering around the streets of Seattle, taking walks and talking about what's going to happen in the story. And we actually started doing that back in 1993. We end up with a lot of notes. We end up with a story that we kind of know what's going to happen. At that point, Phil will sit down with a piece of typing paper and he'll storyboard it out. and he'll actually write they're like little circles with funny faces on them and little, you know, handwritten, you know, not quite word balloons, but just the lines on it. I will look at that. We'll go back and forth. You know, they wouldn't say it like they wouldn't say that, or it doesn't make any sense for them to go there, or whatever. Blah blah, back and forth with the plotting until we find a storyboard that we like, and then he will draw it. I will take that and I will scan it, and then I send part of it to Cheyenne Wright, who's our current color artist. We've had several color artists, but our longest running color artist is Cheyenne. He will be coloring it in Photoshop. I take another copy, just the black and white line art copy. I put that into Adobe Illustrator, and I do all of the scripting straight into Adobe Illustrator. And this is why I can't actually have someone doing the lettering for me, because that final writing pass is happening as I am putting those words into the word balloons in the comic. And sometimes it goes completely sideways and has nothing to do with what was actually being said on the storyboard. If I look at all those funny cartoon faces and they don't seem like they're saying what they were saying before, or if we suddenly realize, oh, we have to remember to get this idea in there, or they wouldn't say it like that, or whatever. So a lot of times the final scripting is very different from what was kind of sketched out on the storyboard. And that's happening.
How much historical research goes into this? I mean, because with something like this, with steampunk, time travel, alternate universe, those kind of things, you can take a lot of liberties.
We take all the liberties.
All the liberties.
We take all the liberties and we put them in a little box. Yeah, we don't actually even claim to be steampunk. We just say, it's a thing. It's Gaslamp Fantasy. It's our thing. It's what we make. And we don't want to fight about whether it is correct or not. It's just what we make. I read a lot of history. Phil reads a lot of science. We both, you know, he reads history and I read science also. Oh boy. That came out strange.
We both
do a lot of reading. We both do a lot of historical reading. We both like to read about the history of science. I'm really interested in Enlightenment history, which you get some really interesting ideas from that. So we do get a lot of inspiration from things that actually happened or things that people thought might actually happen, but we really do just make stuff up.
Any plans for your characters to interact with actual historical characters at any point?
We don't generally go in that direction. Every so often we'll throw stuff out there like, we might put a mention of an actual historical character in if we think it's funny or interesting, but that's not really as much what we do. I'll leave that to the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. Yeah.
All right. Now, there's a comic book. There's a prose novel. You've won 3 Hugo Awards. And what's next?
The next novel. We're working on the 4th novel. I think at some point the novels are going to catch up with the story in the comic, and then we'll just keep on going.
And the novels right now are prose versions of the comic books. Is that right?
They are. When we first started the story, we weren't really sure if we should do novels or comics first because we liked both. And we said, well, we can do both, but let's do the comics first because that's what we're used to self-publishing and that's what we're used to doing. And, you know, it was probably not a good choice because comics are really slow. Comics take forever to finish. And so here we are all these years later still telling the story, whereas if we were doing it in a novel, we would be done and on to the next thing. So.
All right. The website, Girl Genius Online. You're also on Facebook and Twitter. Yeah. Is that right?
We are on Facebook and Twitter, although those... Twitter especially just mirrors the Facebook page. And Facebook... mirrors our actual blog page. So I do go on and I say, hey, the new page is up. But we're not super active in social media, actually. I mean, there is a news page there. Yeah.
All right, Girl Genius Online, and you can find us on all the social media as well, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest, and on and on and on.
Nice.
Of course, we want you to subscribe to our channel here on YouTube so you can catch all the latest videos, especially those coming out of Worldcon 74. And for the latest news headlines, check out scififorme.com.